So I'll turn first to Dr. Carlalynne Meléndez to tell us about her work in the Naguake and connection to the Naguake community.
My name is Carlalynne Meléndez. I am an anthropologist specializing in ethnographies and also ethnocultural anthropology. I'm also a geographer, and my specialty there is geographical information systems and environmental planning. I am also administrator of Naguake community located in Boriquin, Puerto Rico. Naguake is an indigenous revitalization project that started in 2004, and it spans 13 municipalities, stretching from southeastern to northeastern central Puerto Rico, 13 municipalities, over 49 barrios. And the focus was finding out if there was, in the research, if there was a cultural continuity in this region. And we spent several years conducting research. I was a professor at various universities in Puerto Rico, University of Puerto Rico in three different campuses, and Turabo University. So I used my students, and I hate the word used, but my students were taken out to the field every weekend. They hated me for that. But Naguake was born from that research. The challenge of the project was to integrate culture, environment, and genetics in constructing, designing, constructing an indigenous-based community in modern Puerto Rico. And this involved designing programs, community programs, that engage the students, the parents, the grandparents, and the community at large in multiple ways of knowing and understanding, one, their identity, their indigenous identity, two, their heritage, indigenous heritage, and three, for me very important, was their role in protecting and revitalizing the natural and cultural resources of our region. Now, I divide this into two phases. I divide it into the before genetics and after genetics, okay? Before genetics, we were mostly involved in multidisciplinary work in anthropology, geography, and sociology. And there, again, we wanted to see if there was any type of cultural continuity in the area. And our research involved ethnographic, anthropological, bioanthropological, social, environmental, ecological, and biogeographical research. And these are longitudinal studies. They spanned 5 years. They weren't done in a month or 2 months. We kept on going to the field to see if things had changed. And the results from this study, from these studies, helped us design the first programs in the community, all focused on ethnohistory, identity, and linguistics. We were very big on linguistics. And from this research, we developed the first program, the first school program in Puerto Rico called Escuelas en Naguake. Now, I know there was a panelist here who said that she wants Puerto Rico to have an educational program that teaches in Taíno, indigenous culture. Well, we have it. We've had it for 10 years now. It's called... It's called Escuelas en Naguake, Schools en Naguake. But we also develop other projects, community projects like Tureco, to promote tourism in our community, cultural tourism. We also created COA. COA is the implement that the Taínos use to cultivate, and we call it Cosechas Orgánicas Agrícola, and it was to vitalize the agricultural economy in our community. We have farms also that we're cultivating. This before genetics period spanned from 2004 to 2010. And in 2006, we received the visit of a very important person here who I dearly appreciate and love, Sherina Feliciano Santos. She was in the panel before. And she came to the community to do her research on linguistics and also on the Taíno movement. And I was blessed that she came to our community. She helped me. She helped me start up the linguistic project in 2006. So I want an applause for Sharina from Dallas. And if you want to know more about Naguake in the early years, speak to Sharina. She was with me, she accompanied me, the students, and all the trips throughout the whole region. So she knows about those early years. They were very traumatic. Also, towards the end of this period, in 2010, I called up my old alma mater, Binghamton University, to see if there was a person there, a biologist, that was interested in doing genetic research in our community. And they hooked me up with Dr. Miguel Villar, who is also here. Applause for Dr. Miguel Villar. He was very generous with his time. He came down the same year, and we began doing genetic testing on our children, on our school children. It was hair samples we were taking, and we did a lot. And the results from that came back that, yes, there are genetic markers. There are indigenous genetic markers. Later on, Villar was joined by Dr. Theodore Shore from UPenn. And the study took a whole new turn. It became more expansive. It became larger in the sense that it covered a larger area in Boriquin. We had four or five testing centers. We had two in Humacao, we had one in Yabucoa, one in Maunabo, another one in Las Piedras. So all the people would come down and get tested. And I know that when we did the study in, oh. When we did it, oh, let's change it. Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah. Point it towards the booth.
There you go.
Point it towards the booth.
Oh.
There we go.
Okay, those are my students who hated me back then because they had to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and be at the bus station at the university by 6. So those are my students. We're visiting the communities. 198 students in total and 5 years of longitudinal studies. Those are the testing centers in Humacao, Yabucoa, Patillas. So we had multiple testing centers. And there we are taking the samples, Dr. Villar, in the upper right. We even took samples from the police in Humacao. So we wanted to make sure if I got any tickets. And it did help. So the study expanded from 2010 to 2013. And the after genetics is what I'm here for. After genetics, I documented some really important changes in our community. I documented that the students now had a new sense of who they were, their identity. It became more real. The parents became more involved in the classroom. The community at large, people that were afraid, these are jíbaros from the mountains, who were afraid of the genetic testing. Some of them thought that we were gonna clone them. They were coming to me now and requesting, can we have the study? We want to have, you know, our blood tested. So it changed. It changed a lot in our, it catapulted our community to heights that I never thought possible. Also, I had community members coming in with documents, historical documents, certificates, photos. They even had, one document was from 1861. They showed the great-great-grandmother Esparda. And back then, the Spaniards, they used Pardo to identify the indigenous people on the island. So this never happened before genetic testing. They were interested, but they weren't connected. They were connected through anthropology. I even did a teeth samples. We even did impressions. We had a dentist that went into the community and we did impressions to see if there was a shovel tooth and it was present in the community, but I didn't use it. You know, I wanted to go further with it. And we demonstrated that there was cultural continuity from the 2004-2010 study. Definitely there was cultural continuity, but we wanted to see if there was genetic continuity. And the results from Dr. Villar and Dr. Shore's research show that there was definitely cultural continuity. And not only in Naguake, in all of Boriken. But the community is composed, like I said, 13 municipalities, and that's where we concentrated the research. And definitely, we had the markers. But what do we do with those markers? I didn't have to do much. The results spoke for themselves. The people just came to me, interested. They wanted to learn more about their indigeneity. They want to know more about the Taíno. They want to learn more about the music, about the food, even the farming methods. So there was a whole new, they were imbued with a new sense of who am I? I want to learn more about myself. During this phase, we created various programs, school programs. We created Club Naguake. Club Naguake is like our answer to the boys club. Okay? We wanted to break away from those programs and create our own programs. We also did an exchange program with Jamaica and the Kalinago in Dominica. And it was a shocker for my kids when the first students from Jamaica appear on the screen. And my kids have the stereotypical phenotype, okay? Because it is stereotypical. This doesn't mean anything with genetics, okay? So the hair or the skin color, nothing. But it's hard to break away from that in Puerto Rico. Most of the kids do have that phenotype, especially in Naguake. So when my kids saw these students from Jamaica, it was a very harsh reaction. They didn't react immediately. They waited until we got off and they started asking, but Missy, they're not like us. They're different. They're black. And that's where I began speaking to them about genetics, that this la fachada, which is the facade, doesn't mean anything. And I explained to them, they have it in their blood. They are mixed. You are mixed also. Now, I was already prepared for these questions because I have students in Maunabo. Maunabo is, after Luis Aldea, Maunabo is a municipality that has the largest Afro-Boricua population. Okay, and we're in Maunabo. We have four schools there. And I had students come up to me and say, pero Missy, yo no tengo el pelo lacio. Yo no tengo la nariz perfilada. And I told them, I says, you don't have to have that. Do you feel it in your heart? And they said, sí, me siento India, pero eres India. And just by those words, they came into class with a bandana, a green bandana. They started writing stuff on their shirt, yo soy Taína. And I kind of broke them away from que yo soy Taína, okay? Now, and it's an issue that's very touchy for me and very touchy for many people in this audience. I teach my kids, tú no eres Taíno, because I'll be lying to them. Tú eres una mezcla, you are a mix of three races, of three ethnic groups. We are Spanish, we're African, and we're indigenous, in that order. And I know that sounds very harsh for many of you, and it may break many bubbles, but it's the reality of it. It's in our blood. We celebrate in Naguake our Taíno-ness, definitely. But I want my children to know that there is, you know, there's the African and there's the Spanish also. And we need to celebrate those also, and we do celebrate them. To get a perspective. Okay, let me be short here. So we did prove that there was genetic continuity in Naguake. Okay. With the new imbued sense of who we are, our identity, our ethnohistory, our linguistics, the program expanded. Now directors were calling me, please come to the school, we want the program here. Okay. I prepare the teachers. I teach them. I'm an anthropologist. And the teachers, we have 14 teachers, and they have been godsend to the program because they feel their Taino-ness, and they send that message to the children. So they are really the ones that are uplifting the program, not me. Without the teachers, without the parents, without the community, I would not be up here right now. Okay, they're the ones that make Naguake. So when you see Naguake in lights, don't equate it to me. I'm a minor player in Naguake. It's the community that's building Naguake. I'm just an administrator. They tell me what to do. I follow their lead. And that's the way it should be in all the communities. I don't believe in caciqueships. We don't have no cacique. I'm not a cacique. And I don't want to be a cacique. I am an administrator, a modern day word, you know, and that's what I do. I administrate a community. I am an environmental planner. So I use all of that background to create Naguake. And Naguake is successful, again, not because of me, because of the community, because they're interested. And now, after genetics, they are more interested. Now there are people that want to open up new land to farm. Our children, and this is something very special for me, and I'm going to wrap up with this. I created a program called Indigenous Science last year. And the program has to do with introduction of science into the classroom. Don't forget, a Naguake program is not an after-school program. It's a regular program inserted into the schools. Okay? So it's not that we're there like... No, we're there full time. And my sixth graders came to me with this worry that what's going to happen with our land, with our forest? Comerío is a beautiful municipality. We're located in a valley, and we're surrounded by mountains, and it's all forested. But for these sixth graders to gain that awareness that we have to protect our forests, for my children, that spoke volumes, okay, of the program. Now they're interested in protecting their land. So now we're creating a reserve in Comerío to protect that land. And they're the ones that are designing it. They're the ones that are working with the GIS. I taught them GIS, how to do thematic maps, and they're producing maps to protect that forested area. And I think that's the total of Naguake, that the kids get involved. These are seeds. And one more thing, in Naguake, unlike other communities like the Cherokee and the Crow, where the grandparents, they pass on traditional knowledge to the children, in Naguake, we don't have that. We have been disconnected, okay? We have been disconnected completely. So, in Naguake, the children are passing the knowledge to the grandparents. They're teaching the grandparents about Taíno culture. And in Puerto Rico, most of my students, they're being raised by the grandparents. The fathers are either in jail, or they left home, the mother is working in San Juan, and they're being raised. I would say that 80% of them are being raised by the grandparents. But where is this information going? They're transmitting this information to their grandparents. They're older now. But they are the seeds. They will be transmitting that information to their children. So we're gonna, and I'm seeing this right now. We've been doing this for 13 years, and I'm seeing those seeds take root and flourish. And that is Naguake. And I thank you so much. And if you wanna learn more about Naguake, just go in Naguake and look us up. Send me an email, you want to visit us, you want to visit our farms, you feel free to visit. It's open doors, okay? Thank you.